You know what our little sister always says is that it's always the right time to focus on dharmic truth, and if we can make it constant, that should be the goal. We should do it. So I feel it's always the right time to tape. It's always seize any opportunity to be charitable in giving out clarity. In the book I Am That, Sagarada Maharaj is questioned about the different types of humans, and someone says, you know, it seems like there's humanoids and there's humans. And he says, well, Maharaj says, well, there are those who are rajistic and tamistic, like the humanoids, who they're a certain way, and then there's those who are more sattvic, those are like humans, who are full of clarity and charity, full of clarity and charity. So here we're charitable with clarity. Charitable with clarity. That's how I feel. I don't have the means to be charitable, like writing a check, although I did give to some sob story in church today and help people down in Peru or something. So I gave what little I had there. And you know, but that's not really big charity at all in terms of helping people. I said, why don't you give them clarity? I mean, what people need really here is clarity. That's, you know, dharmic culture is not the ones that write the big checks. That's business culture, the rajistic people more. But we're supposed to dispense clarity. That's our charity. And that's the one that really works. That's the one that truly is so helpful. So here we are. It's on a Sunday evening. And I heeded the Holy Spirit's advice and got my hair cut. I said, you know what? There's something that reminded me, like maybe my hair is kind of a little messy. I got it cut and, you know, looking really super neat and super conservative. And it's the time for that. It's the time to say, you know, I'm quote unquote human, not humanoid. And I think that distinction is really apt right now because I went into... I had to go to some place Sunday evening, and the people out and around, man, it was something else. Not to mention what happened in church, let's just say the people were very weird, and that is an extreme understatement. I said, what in the world is going on? Where am I? I'm looking at everybody. There's people going lumbering like this with motorcycle jackets on, with some, you know, bizarre death logo, tattoos all over. This woman gets out of a car and she's got this, I mean, I can't hardly even describe her. I've never seen anything like it. She was like blonde, white skin with black ink tattoo, just this like ferocious Amazon, like warrior goddess stuff. Like, she's just like, I've never seen anything like it. And she was like a zombie. The people are like so zombie-like. And I'm saying, oh my God, this is real. I was scared. I was like, this is in church. This woman, the weirdest woman I've ever seen. And I thought she had a bomb. I thought she was going to set up a bomb. She had a backpack, and she was positioning it, and she was going around the church at different places and sitting down and positioning like this and looking. And then she sat right in front of me and spent a lot of time there acting in the most bizarre way. I was doing a lot of praying. And then suddenly she left. We're like, what is going on here? She was... out of her mind is an understatement. Not in her right mind. Homeless, alcoholic, you know, everything. I felt so... I just prayed for her. I prayed, you know, and said, tried to give her confidence that, you know, you will turn it around. Okay, the Holy Spirit will turn it around for you. Just like it turned it around, the Holy Spirit turned my life around, hit bottom. It will turn your life around, and you're a future saint. So if you see these people, well, say, look, this is a future saint. After she left, right on cue, like almost like 10 seconds later, this is the middle of service, this huge hulking black man in this dark black suit comes in, and he sits exactly right in front of me. He puts his arm on the pew like that, right in my face almost. And he was just this dark, heavy presence. It was amazing. And he was so messed up as well. He had 1.5 feet in the grave. And I was just saying, what in the world is going on here? So I would, when you meet these humanoid people, and some of them are, you don't know what, you get a little concerned, like, what's going on? So just say, ah, God is sending me future saints, because these people are close to bottoming out. And when you bottom out, that's when you turn to the Holy Spirit. Once you turn to the Holy Spirit, you're going to be a saint, plain and simple. The Holy Spirit is in the business of making saints and is not in any other business, actually, at all. It looks at us, it sees saints. And then all it does is reshape our expectations until we can accept its vision of us. It has a vision for all of us, and it's all these beautiful, perfect saints. So God sent a couple saints to be, to sit in front of me. Maybe God said, hey, look what I can do. Maybe God was saying, this guy, he was once, down even lower than you are mentally. And look what the Holy Spirit has done for him. I'll do the same for you. The Holy Spirit will do the same for you. Maybe they needed to just get that, some sort of, to sit near me somehow, to get this feeling of confidence that their lives can be turned around. So we really have to focus on this, because people are really going down the tubes right now. They're going down into humanoidism, which is really kind of a cross between an animal and a human, tell you the truth. It really is. And it's so shocking. I keep getting caught, like, keep getting shocked by it. But it's difficult to know how to feel, what to say, what to do. Perhaps it's better your spirit just says, ah, God just sent me a couple of future saints. Great. And just let them sit close to you. Just let them sit there. This has have to be quite a bit, actually. It seems that those who are really on the bottom come and sit near me. I've got a huge church. Why do they always come and sit right in front of me like that, wandering off the street? I don't know. I get maybe that's it. That's it. Because it's when you can no longer call upon the flesh to help you. And the reading today was St. Paul talking about how the flesh profiteth nothing, and those who rely on the flesh are certainly going to die. Those who rely on the one mind, Christ, and the grace of God, are certainly going to live eternal life. And he made this really beautiful talk about the difference, between the two, the humanoids and the humans, so to speak. So when you get so far down that nobody can help you, no human being can help you. I got to that point. No human being could help me. Well, no flesh-based human being, you might say. No humanoid could help me, that's for sure. But the flesh couldn't help me. The logic of the flesh, which is really the ego, couldn't help me. I couldn't rely on anyone. I couldn't, had no help at all, and didn't know where to look at all. And that's when I just said, wow, help. The Spirit cried out for help, and the Holy Spirit answered immediately. Immediately, I felt the presence of a higher intelligence, someone, absolute confidence in me. And the Holy Spirit had absolute confidence in me, in itself, and in me, saying, in my mind, you're already a saint. You just have to reshape your expectations, but you're already there, for sure. No doubt about it. And then I said, what do I need to do? I said, you just need to, to steady work on what has turned out to be my expectations, right? Of what failure to change what I am, and keep attempting to unfixate, these expectations that we have. Well, we have failed and failed and failed and failed and failed in our attempt to change what we are. And so we think, well, I'm going to fail then at trying to, whatever I do, I'm going to fail. So it's not easy to believe that you can possibly succeed at getting free of failure. It's funny, because failure thinks that it must fail at getting free of failure also. Isn't that interesting? You just don't have the confidence. But the Holy Spirit has the confidence, absolute confidence. So those of us who are sattvic and really practicing, you know, we have to recognize there are the world has been, you know, overrun by humanoids, actually. Silicon Valley is a real center of that, actually. Berkeley, Santa Cruz, San Francisco, you know, Oakland, the whole Bay Area is full of humanoids. Silicon Valley, the tech humanoids. You don't see sattvic people around anymore. I said, where have they gone? Well, they're not here, that's for sure. So I said, God, the Holy Spirit, you know, it'd be really good if I was someplace else and not hanging around these people, because it really does bring you down. It really does. It's not good to hang around them. Unless we ourselves are saints, such that we see them also as saints and we don't even see. But their attitudes can really tempt us back into what we don't want to be tempted back into. So we'll see what happens. But I think it's really important now to present yourself and see yourself as not one of those humanoids, okay? Not one of those humanoids. So I'm trying to be, you know, neater and cleaner and more positive-minded and just stay away from the wildlife. As the Holy Spirit told me, you have to stay away from the wildlife, so to speak, the whole culture of humanoidism. And it's just, the internet's nothing but that, basically. Because that's what's so ultra chic right now. That's the ego's play. That's what happens when you follow the ego, is you believe that being a humanoid is the answer. You know, part human, part animal. So to speak, part spirit, part not spirit. Part creature, part spirit, you know, like that. Which means it's a belief in fixation, is what it is. Because the ego loves animals, doesn't love humans, because animals don't seem to have the clarity to recognize that what's going on, that this is all just a pretense, a dream. Of fixation and unfixation, just pretense. And so the ego feels safer, says, no, if people were more like animals, we wouldn't even think about, you know, giving up death. Wouldn't even think about it. Animals never think about giving up death, but humans, yeah, they do. They, in fact, even know how to do it. That's terrifying to the ego. So the ego hates humans, it really does, but it loves humanoids. And even loves creatures even more, animals. It wants this to be animal planet, where, you know, humanoids rule, and there are no more humans on the planet. That's it. And it may get its wish, because humans may very well go somewhere else, actually. We're certainly capable of that. And I don't mean jumping on some rocket ship either to do it. Not at all. It's you work with your expectations. You expect that you can do it, and it's just done. You're able to just, as good as done. So, continuing to eat, you know, sattvic food, books right near me. Wherever I get bored, I immediately open one of these books, these great books by the Dharma kings and the gurus, and just read what they have to say. So I'm just getting peppered all day by that, without having to put up with Facebook. It's nice to have books around. You just open them up anywhere you want. You read something. Wow! Boom! Thank you. That's fantastic help. and you put the book down. There's no commercials. You're not going to have all these pictures, you know, of humanoids. Constant pressure from humanoids on the internet. It's just unrelenting, because that's what the ego wants. It wants to drug us all down into humanoids, lower us all down there, and so staying off the internet and getting your stuff from books is much, much better, much, much better. For the most part, you know, here these videos can't be in books, but if you just go onto YouTube and this channel and you can cut out a lot of that humanoid stuff, but not all of it. I mean, the trailers they have are just all humanoid stuff, aren't there? Robotic, superhero, humanoid, it's all that stuff. It's so obvious that you just, you know, wonder, have they no shame? And apparently not. Apparently not. So, got a very short haircut. One of the shortest I've ever had, for sure. And it looks great. I'm happy with it. That's terrific. And I'm able to look, you know, really, real conservative in values, you know. In other words, sattvic, very sattvic. Serious, upright, you know, virtuous, ethical, conservative, the feel of you know, no wildlife here. There's no wildlife going on here. No humanoidness going on here. And it's important to carry yourself that way. During these times, so you're making a clear distinction between the two situations. In the Bible, it says it, the sheep and the goats. The sheep are this sort of meek, humble, sattvic energy, whereas the goats have this rajistic, you know, I'll eat anything, you know, this wild look in their eyes. I don't like goats. I never have. They give me the creeps. They really do give me the creeps. And those are humanoids. They're like goats. So that's the separation between the sheep and the goats that is taking place in this world, and it's now becoming extremely obvious. You know, it's so blatant. Holy cow. It's like that woman I saw in the parking lot was like some creature that came out of the abyss. Skinny, you know, probably a meth addict. The way the skin and bones, but tall and lanky and skinny, with cropped blonde hair, and in a real kind of crudish way, and just this, the tattooing was just over the top, and it's just mind-numbing almost, looking at that, just mind-numbing. So this, what is this creature? I mean, from the Black Lagoon or something. Welcome to the apocalypse. We're really into the apocalypse now. And so identify yourself with the new way. Identify yourself with the new way and don't apologize for it. And pray for help. Pray for help. And even more importantly, assert you've already been helped. It's a done deal. You know, and thank God, grace of God, for putting you in the right place so that you can be saved from the fate of believing you're a humanoid, which is not a good fate to have right now. It's not a good fate. It's a tough road out of that belief system. That man in front of me, oh good Lord, was he suffering? And was he... he looked like a toad, you know? Really he did. Like a horrible, suffering toad. Like spirit that was trying to be a creature, you know, he led a creature existence, and he was just in anguish, and he was coming to church hoping to find an answer, and that woman must have coming to church also to try to find an answer, but, you know, they're desperate. The answer is the Holy Spirit. It's not church, it's the Holy Spirit, and that's found within you. It's not found in a church, it's found within you. But those who bought him out are the ones who really get it, because then they reach this utter desperation. total desperation. And that's when they're willing to listen to the Holy Spirit. They're willing now to pay attention, saying, wow, I got nowhere else to turn. Let's do it your way, like that. And then that's repentance. And they're on the road to sainthood right then and there. So you can say to these people, look, I guarantee you, you're already a saint. You know, you just have these expectations of failure that get in the way. Just your expectations. Just reshape your expectations, but only the Holy Spirit can help you with that. In a fundamental sense, you know, others can help once, but once you are really trusting in the Holy Spirit, then you can get help from other sources. But the real basis of it is the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, which sees you as a saint. Absolutely, as perfect, perfectly free of any faults, any notion of failure to be what we are, you know, any pretense or any belief that we could be anything other than what we are is it doesn't exist. No sense of failure at all in us. No sense of, not a, even trace of the notion of failure. So it's the Holy Spirit that really does the redeeming work, and the rest of us, we just are like assistants. We give encouragement along the way. This is a fact. So we have to do our best to see that everyone we look at is really a saint. Perfect saint. And this has to be recognized by us. So I have to do more work in that area for sure, because we're being tested, because the people we're seeing these days think that they're, you know, humanoids, part creature, really. And so they're denying that they're saints. They're denying that they're perfect, you know. And we can't buy into their denial of it. We cannot buy into that. But they're very convincing. That's the problem these days. Very convincing. So we just ask the Holy Spirit to help us with this. Really, we really need help at this time. It is getting really archaic right now. The archaic revival is underway. The humanoid archaic revival is most certainly underway. So we will get it. We will get it. We don't want to force the issue. I just want to bring it up. Bring it up. And we don't struggle for results. Don't struggle for results. They will arise for sure. Everyone really is Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. That's the truth. That's what we really are. And everyone is actually already that. They're simply pretending to be fixating the mind. They're pretending that they have a fixated mind, but they don't. Okay, that sounds a little weird, but they're just trying to find a way to fixate the mind. They're not finding it. They're just trying to find it. But again, they haven't found it and they never will, which means they haven't changed at all, which means they're completely normal, actually, which is what Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma is. She showed us what we are, perfectly normal. Everyone is already that, or everyone is already that for sure. For sure, and without any doubt or worry or concern that anyone could possibly fail. You see, when we see everyone the way they really are, we realize they can't possibly fail to be to be normal. It's impossible that there could be any failure of normality ever happening. So to see everyone as they truly are, we should do that. Because what else is there to see? These efforts that we're making, they won't do anything to our normality. Nothing at all. Nothing at all. So it's interesting. I had this dream last night of this bizarre woman. And then I decided to look at her. Instead of turning away, I looked at her. I said, wait a minute, you're not fooling me. And then suddenly, she just melted. And there was Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, there. I said, wow. In other words, normality. So we can see one another as normal and overlook these bizarre efforts to change what we are because they don't work. So why should we pay any attention and why should we judge anyone? There's nothing to judge except that they don't work. Nothing works to change what we are. So why try to make distinctions between all these different efforts? Everyone's got this, has their own unique effort, right? I mean, it's amazing. The people I saw today, it's entertaining, I guess, you know, really, like gawky, I feel like I'm back in the summer of love in 1967, going through Haight-Ashbury, which I did. I drove through there with a family. Dad took us through there. I was like, you know, wow, not in Kansas anymore. It's like that's kind of everywhere, but it's the archaic. It's an archaic humanoid revival. Similar, but different. It's people are all on meth now instead of pot and LSD, pretty much so, right? They're on heroin and meth. A friend of mine lives over in Santa Cruz, and he says you cannot believe the heroin use over there. And the illegal activity is going on. He said it's just rotten to the core over there, which I certainly it didn't surprise me. But the extent of it, like I said, they pass out free needles, and it's exploded heroin use over there since they started passing out free needles. They do a lot of stuff like that there. It encourages, of course, drug use. They're trying to stop spread of, you know, hepatitis and AIDS and all this kind of stuff. But it causes exponential growth of it all. So people are really, really trying their best to fixate the mind, okay? But the Holy Spirit already knows that it never happened. It'll never happen. It's already never happened. So there's a nice way to talk. It's already never happened. How about that as a nice phrase for the new way? It's already never happened. It's already never happened. It's already never happened. There's only normality to see. That's all there is to see. Everything else is a hallucinating the absence of normality. It's not a seeing at all. Hallucinating the absence of normality is not a seeing. Okay, it's not a seeing. Okay, but seeing normality is all there is to see. So it's already never happened. That's very dharmic. Thank you, Holy Spirit. It's already never happened. It's already never happened. Wow. It's already never happened. Wow. So we cannot really afford to take, you know, to stop this dharmic focus, really just to stop it. We can't really afford it right now. The archaic revival is underway, and I have a feeling, my feeling is it's going to suddenly explode on us all. And the inmates will realize the inmates have taken over the asylum. There's no question about it. At that point, we're going to, as Longchenpa says, retreat. Song of the Enchanting Wildwood is all about when he says, when the Dharma really collapses in the world and the humanoids take over, he says, you got to retreat. And keep your dharmicness going for the benefit of future generations. It's very important. Do not beat your head against the wall. He says there are times when it collapses so bad that no matter what you do, they hate you. You know, they'll vilify you and do the opposite of what you say. They're just intractable. They go through this because they're trying to be creatures who don't understand. And they're frustrated because they still are attracted to what you say, and so they get really angry at you because they think that you're ruining their salvation. They think becoming creatures is the answer. Automatically indifferent. To reality. Automatically indifferent to reality. They think it's saving them from the abyss. So during these times, Longchenpa directly has stated it, you need to retreat. You need to retreat away from those influences. So, you know, I'm all in for that. And I pray to him all the time and affirm all the time, thank you for your great retreat that you've already provided for us, you know. Yeah. So abnormality, we can say, it's already never happened. It's already never happened. And the retreat, it's already happened. It's already happened, so to speak. So we have to be very careful. We don't get into the begging mode too much. You know, like, oh, come on, help us out. That doesn't help so much. We need to shape our expectations so that we can accept what they already have. I guarantee you, Longchenpa already has the remedy for us. But the only thing that gets in the way is our expectations. So if we don't expect it, that's getting in the way because we would be too shocked by it and retreat from it. So Longchenpa arranged a little mini retreat for me in May. And it was so beautiful and so extraordinary. I was shocked the whole time. I was just like dumbfounded. I said, this is so much better than I even expected. So I really had to gear myself up for that. And even then, it was just like, you know, don't pinch me. You know, this is a dream. It's so beautiful. It was so extraordinarily beautiful what he did. So it's our expectations. We really have to work on our expectations. We have to expect that we are going to experience this wonderful transitioning towards normality, okay, which is perfect eternal glory beyond, and we cannot describe it because it's the freedom and the freshness and the instantaneousness of it all, the way that it is. It's the way that it the way that it presents is the essentialness of it, the way that reality presents, so to speak. So we cannot understand that at this point. So we can imagine stuff, but the presentation is not there. The frame of reference is wrong. So it's better not to struggle to try and imagine it, but rather allow yourself to go into places that help us trend in that direction. It's really important. And the Bay Area is not one of those places, I have to say. We well, as a bee just showed up. Great. We went up to San Francisco once, and then we were coming down. We took a wrong turn. We ended up in Pacifica. Then we took some back streets. We ended up in somewhere else, and we got to a gas station. We needed gas. Well, first we went into a convenience store there, and we got out of there. The people that were coming into that convenience store, scared the heck out of us. And we just left. We got to get out of here. And then we went to the gas station, and while we were filling gas, the people who went to that gas station, I mean, also, I was just astonished. That was last year. I said, "This, we don't belong here at all." Very creature-like. But you see, when humans try to become creatures, they get really weird. It's not a good mix. Okay, it's really not. And they're trying their very best to do this, so this produces tremendous weirdness, but they're so boisterous of one another that they think that they're just being really cool, they're doing the right thing, and there's nothing wrong. And what do you mean, nothing wrong with me? We're supposed to be really weird. And no, you're not. That's the ego's way. So we left there, and we're just like, wow, we are never going back to this area again. That is really something, what we experienced there. And this is just common throughout the Bay Area, just absolutely common. It's just a haven for that. So I don't belong here at all. I'm saying the longchamp, but I don't belong here, at all. But for whatever reason, it is what it is. It is what it is. What's that? Is that a bee on my face? It was. The bee went on my face. Did you see that? Yeah. Wow. The bee was walking on my face like that and walked up to my eye. Wow, that was so extraordinary. Hey, bee, thank you. What was that about? Uh-oh. There it is right there. Be nice. Okay. Stay calm, bee. I mean, don't fly on me again like that. I don't know. My fly. Wow. Haven't had that happen before. Never in my life have I had a bee fly onto my face and crawling on my face and go into my eye like that. I couldn't hit it or anything. I had to use my breath. So calm down, bee. Calm down, calm down, calm down. What's going on here? Well, it's one of those bees that's set to die, because it's not go didn't go back to the hive. So it's hanging out with the light here before it dies. Full of pollen. Wow. Kind of like those creatures or humanoids are talking about. They're headed to death, towards death, and they think it's salvation. And they're getting real frantic now. They're in this franticness. Like this bee is very frantic. So what the bee is showing us is there's this phase that you go through in the world. The world goes through these phases, as Longchenpa pointed out. They said there's phases where we become very non-dharmic. And when there's about to be this implosion or death, the people get very frantic. This bee is very, very frantic. And that's the way people are right now. And you can't really calm that bee down. I mean, I'm not able to calm the bee down. I don't know what to do. It's going towards this false light. It's, if you might call it that, this, what is it, mercury vapor light or something. It's attracted to this false light. He's gotten confused. Can't find his way home. He's burning himself out. What are those bugs doing flying around at nighttime? I don't know. Where do they come from? Where do bugs come from? Well, where do all these humanoids, where do they all come from? Attracted by the false light of materialism, it helps them slide right into humanoidism and creatureness, actually. Is flying around everywhere right now. I'm having to dodge it. Holy cow. It's kind of like you're in the Bay Area. You got to dodge these people and these cars like this. It's not good. It makes you feel agitated a little bit. Wow. And it's not going to stop. It's not going to stop this. It's not going to stop this. Maybe we should stop. Where'd it go? Oh, it's crawling right here. Okay. Whoa! It's on my leg now. It's on my leg. It's on my leg right now. Whoa! Okay. Wow. So Holy Spirit, what is this? What's your advice here? It's zooming all over the place. It's frantic. It's like that woman in church today. She went all over the church. How many different places did she end up sitting? She kept moving and moving and moving and moving and moving. She was frantic. She couldn't sit still. She could. Wow, this bee is super active. Okay. Can't find its way home. Its orientation is messed up. Already never happened. Already never happened. Already never happened. Right? So, what is the answer? What does the Holy Spirit want us? How does it want us to relate to this situation right here? Is a question, right? It's on my shirt now. It's on my shirt, pants, shirt, face. I'm in a combat zone right here. You know, this is no fun. It's a thank you bee, because this bee is portraying for us exactly what I've been talking about these humanoids and how we need to take refuge from them, because it disturbs us. Okay, this bee is very disturbing, isn't it? And these humanoids are quite disturbing towards our folk attempt to see them as the perfect saints they really are. As perfectly normal. And we have a right to focus on seeing everyone as perfectly normal, because it's already what they're trying to do is already never happened. It's already never happened. They are still normal, but they can certainly disturb us in our efforts to recognize this, as this bee is certainly disturbing us right now. Ah, it's on my arm. When it stops flying, that means it's landed somewhere. See, now I'm very disturbed. Like, where is this bee landed now? I don't know. So you see how disturbing that is? Is it on my head? And so I'm all shaken up, nervous by this. So the bee gave this command performance, which illustrates perfectly what I'm talking about. Wanting to take refuge from humanoids doesn't mean that you think that they're bad or that they're not normal. They are, but they're very, very clever at presenting themselves as not normal. And this is undermines our effort to see them as normal. Okay? So the new way certainly has the right to, we certainly have the right to get away from that. Get away from that. Because, another bug in my eye, not seeing them as normal only hurts the situation. It only hurts them. It doesn't help them. It makes things worse. Makes things worse. Again, now we can settle down. The bee is somehow, after its command performance. Thank you, bee. That was extraordinary. All blessings to you, bee. Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, I literally know she is me. She is what we are. She is the face of normality. Somehow appearing out of nowhere from the one mind. And the one mind is saying, you are this. All is this. This is you. And it's true. I am. And I say, I am Anandamayi. I am Anandamayi. There's no doubt in my mind. I am Anandamayi. There isn't some person Anandamayi. She wasn't a person. She was what we truly are. The one mind, the oneness. Just with a body there, but no identification with the body on the part of the one mind, just showing us this is what you really are, this is what you truly are. And the moment I first saw her, I realized in a video, I said, this is what I am. I know. How is this possible that somehow what I truly am has suddenly shown up in the world? How extraordinary! So. I am that, you know, no question about it. And so are you, and so is everyone. Ah, it's back. It landed on something. Right behind me. Oh, it's up on the other light now. Okay, the highlight. Oh, okay. Well, we may have to leave the vicinity here. It went into the flower there. It went inside the flower. Can you just stay in there and be quiet? Like a lotus blossom, it went inside of it. No, it's popping out. maybe it's looking for pollen in this flower. It says, "Ah, this looks familiar. Why don't you just crawl inside there and take a rest?" You know? Ah. Uh-oh. It's on my shirt now, behind me. Oh. Wow. Okay. All right, I think we need to wrap this up, is what we need to do. We need to retreat to the wildwoods, is what we need to do. So without further ado, let's do this. This has been quite an extraordinary experience, and the message is loud and clear. You know, at some point, you realize the bee's not going to stop, won't stop. The humanoids, they're not going to stop what they're up to. And so we really need to recognize this and say, okay, enough's enough. And here we go to the enchanting wildwoods. The new way is wow. The new way is wow. The new way is wow.